Hi, this is Ford again. Welcome to part 11 of our Tsuba project. In part 10, we cut out and refined the ryohits, the two openings on either side of the central oval of the Tsuba. Today, we're going to focus on refining the outer rim, scraping it and burnishing it. So follow along. Right, so this next stage, you've possibly seen on most sword fittings, these corners been punched in. The reason for that is so that the opening, which is generally much bigger than the tang of the sword, can then be made a little smaller in those spots, which is where the blade proper is secured. These marks are generally known as kuchi-beni. The Higo province artists had another peculiarity where they would punch a little pattern along these edges, oftentimes just little semicircles. Some people are of the opinion that you can attribute work based on the number of kuchi-beni decorative punch marks along the side. I wouldn't be that confident, frankly, because they're so easy to do. What I'm going to do is use kuchi-beni just on the corners. Not because this is going on a particular blade, but because it adds a visual interest to the overall composition. So I'm using it unashamedly as a decorative element, but it does have a functional aspect. So I shall punch those marks, and if at some point down the line somebody wants to mount it, that can be done relatively easily. Back in the day, I imagine when a Tsuba was made and sold, it wouldn't have had those marks added. So it's a bit of a contrivance. But I'm making a sculptural piece, and I'm choosing to use this. Right. Like the first thing, of course, if we're punching in this on the Tsuba, is the back of it needs to be supported. I'm using this hammer. I've used this for years now for this job, and for fitting sekigane as well. I'm going to use this as a little anvil. So I'm going to mount this in the vise. There we go. That means I can support the Tsuba on that face. It's ever so slightly curved, so it's not going to catch the edges, and there's a slight stony surface to it. There will be a little bit of bruising perhaps on the other side corresponding to where I use the punch, but it's going to be quite minor. Now, the punch I'm using is a deliberately irregular one. It's ever so slightly softened curve on the surface, and the edges are very gently rounded. I've roughened it up a little bit over the years, but I'm using that deliberately because it's quite organic, and I'm not trying to make deliberate mechanical square punch marks. You can if you wish, of course, it's entirely up to you what you want to do. All right, I'm using a fairly hefty, weighty hammer to strike the punch. I'm doing that because I want to do it in one blow, really, and I don't want to have to flail at it too wildly. So it's a nice weight, and it'll give me the impact I need in one. So now I'm placing the Tsuba on the hammer, temporary anvil, placing the punch in position. Now this is obviously useful if you've got a third hand. I don't, and my third hand is behind the camera, so I'm just going to give it one whack, and hopefully that's the job done there. Try the other side, turn the punch a little bit, and I'm deliberately trying to make them not symmetrical. Right, I'm going to do the hot edge, or the sharp edge, the narrow end of the blade. And the other side also. That will do. And you can just see perhaps slightest bruising. But because it was on a slightly stony face, it hasn't caused too much distortion of the metal surface. All right, so I've done all the marks. I was a little bit dissatisfied with that one there. It was too large a surface that was boring, so I did another strike into that one, and I think that completes that little part of the decoration. The final point to make is that kuchi-beni tend to be almost always only on the front side, and the back is left plain. There, you see the occasional one that's been mangled on the back, but generally speaking, that's the convention. It's fairly obvious, really, if you have it on a flat anvil and you're punching from the front to distort the metal. If you turn it around the other side, you're not going to be distorting it. You're just going to be pushing it the other way again. So that's that. Right, so I'm going to take the masking tape off and let's have a look at that rim. All right, got all the tape off. I've given it a wipe down with some lacquer thinners to get rid of any residue of the stickiness and all the gunk. It's nice to tie it up. I'm just going to go over one more time with a very fine file to make sure the outer rim is nice and smooth prior to more fine finishing with a scraper. Using the half round part, just very lightly dressing it. And I'm looking at the play of light so that the surface is just a nice roll, light can roll over it nicely. I think that will do. And the light plays nicely on that. So there's an underlying surface to now refine further. And now using a scraper, one of those we used earlier perhaps, just running along very lightly. It's copper, it's quite soft, even though it's been hammered. I'm just very gently taking away the file marks. Now you could use emery paper, and you can use stones, but I believe that this was pretty much how they would have finished things. I'm pulling it towards me at this point, angling it, because if you come directly across the file marks, you can get some chatter happening. So you angle it slightly. He's pushing away now. So I'm modifying my technique, or rather changing my approach as I go. Don't fight it. Let the tool skate across the surface. Find the natural planes and try to force the tool into the metal. You'll just end up creating bigger divots. And because I'm going quite lightly and I'm getting rid of the file marks, I'm also allowing the tool create its own skin. So when I burnish it, it won't be perfect mirror, it'll have a very subtle ripple to it. right? So as I said, I've scraped up the outside. The objective was to remove the file marks. Depending on how you work it, you can get a very smooth finish. Or as I've opted, I've allowed it to develop its own little wrinkle on the surface, because I'm not going to burnish that. So though it'll be smooth and relatively shiny, it's not going to be a glass-like surface. I want a little bit of activity in the surface, which is why I've allowed these little wrinkles to develop as I've gone around, especially on the edges here. Now I'm just going to burnish. So a burnisher is just a polished, hardened steel rod, and it's you're basically just compressing the metal. You can use a lubricant like spit. That's the most convenient. And just gently moving back and forth, working. A bit like filing, establish a little line of polished metal, and then roll forward. Not going too hard. I don't want to create too many little ridges. And then moving on. See, I'm supporting the piece on the towel and I'm resting my hand on the top, so making it easy for myself. Keeping the burnish in a relatively stable position and moving the Tsuba around. I think I'm satisfied with that. It's smooth enough. It's very bright at the moment, very glossy. Before I patinate, I'm going to give it a very soft polish with something like a scouring powder, perhaps. It'll clean the metal, ready for patina, but also take a little bit of that hard glass-like shine off, which I'm not particularly interested in this stage. All right, so you've got the soft molten undulating surface now, and that'll do. I think all we have to do now is sign it, and then of course the last stage will be to put some color on it. Metal's often greasy, so when you come to paint on it with sumi, it's wise to make sure it is degreased. So I'm just using talcum powder in this little pom-pom. Hopefully that's enough. And the final flourish.